Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Defiance of the Patriots, The Boston Tea Party and the Making of America, by Benjamin L. Carp, narrated by Joe Barrett. Introduction. Teapot in a Tempest. And now I pray you, sir, for still 'tis beating in my mind, your reason for raising this sea storm. Miranda to Prospero, Act 1, Scene 2, Shakespeare, The Tempest. It seems we have troublesome times a-coming, for there is great disturbance abroad in the earth, and they say it is tea that caused it. So then, if they will quarrel about such a trifling thing as that, what must we expect but war? And I think, or at least fear, it will be so. Jemima Condit, October 1, 1774. On December 16, 1773, at a crowded meeting in the largest church in Boston, the leather dresser, Adam Colson, supposedly shouted, "Boston Harbor a teapot this night!" Colson then marched down to the water's edge at Griffin's Wharf to make his metaphor come true. If a tempest in a teapot describes a big disturbance about a small matter, Boston, in the midst of a turbulent political crisis over the authority of the British Empire, was in this moment a teapot in a tempest. Colson and his companion staged an act of rebellion that would have worldwide significance. About 100 men boarded the 3 trading ships that were riding at Griffin's Wharf in Boston Harbor. They hoisted 340 chests onto the decks. These chests contained more than 46 tons of tea. The men smashed open the chests, releasing the leaves' bittersweet aroma into the air. It was the intoxicating smell of exotic luxury, and a couple of men were so unable to resist it that they stuffed some of the leaves into their pockets. The rest of the men remembered that there were principles at stake. They dumped the tea into the salt water below. The ships, which had arrived in the previous weeks from London, were named the Dartmouth, for an aspiring port town, the Eleanor, for a woman, and the Beaver, in homage to New England's industrious work ethic. The tea destroyers hailed from all walks of life. Men with strong backs and hard Yankee accents, they were a mix of young merchants, craftsmen, apprentices, and workers. They believed in a wrathful God, and they feared that the temptations of tea would turn them into tools of a corrupt, tyrannical empire. The grown men among them believed they were embarked on a noble deed of patriotic virtue. The younger boys thrilled to the idea of an evening spent wreaking chaos and destruction. The men and boys had names like Thomas Melville, Joshua Wyeth, and, improbably, George Robert Twelves Hughes. On the evening of December 16th, they spoke for all the dissidents in Boston who had squared off against the policies of the British government. The Boston Tea Party wasn't a rebellion or even a protest against the king, but it set in motion a series of events that led to open revolt against the British crown. The destruction of the tea, which became known as the Boston Tea Party 50 years later, was a bold, defiant act of political mobilization. These destroyers had carefully calculated their reasons for dumping the tea on that particular evening. They needed to destroy the tea before the stroke of midnight. If they failed, then the hated customs officers would seize the tea and make it available for sale. The destroyers were trying to stop the tea from being sold at all. They would have preferred to force the captains of the 3 ships to weigh anchor, pilot their way back out of Boston Harbor, and carry the tea back to London. But when the ship's owners proved reluctant to send their ships back, the men decided they had no other choice but to destroy the tea. Why did the destroyers want to prevent the tea from landing in Boston? The easiest answer is that Parliament had imposed a tax on tea. Many people thought this tax was reasonable, but a dissident faction of Bostonians, the majority of the townspeople in fact, believed that Parliament had no right to raise revenue from American colonists without the colonists' consent. The Bostonians worried that more taxes were on the way. They knew that the revenue from the taxes paid the salaries of the civil officials that the British government had appointed to enforce the imposition of taxes. To the Bostonians and other dissidents throughout the colonies, this was a blatant example of tyranny. Even worse, this tea was to be sold by the preferred agents of a monopoly company, the British East India Company. Parliament had imposed this new arrangement under the Tea Act, which now threatened American merchants by cutting them out of the tea trade. If Parliament could sell tea to America this way and earn revenue from the sales, then the British government could start creating new monopolies on the sale of other products. Exorbitant prices, mammoth monopolies, and crushing taxes might leave Americans with nothing. Dissidents were frightened, not just because of what they saw happening in Boston, but because of what they had seen happening throughout the world. Tyranny and liberty were locked in a constant struggle, and the dissident Bostonians knew which side they supported. The story of the Boston Tea Party was not just a local story, but a global story. The British East India Company, which was gaining territorial control over more and more South Asians, made much of its profit selling tea, a product grown by East Asians. When Europeans and Americans drank tea, they mixed it with sugar, farmed by enslaved Africans in the Caribbean. When the Bostonians dumped this tea in the harbor to protest the actions of the East India Company and the British Parliament, they dressed as Native Americans. These were just some of the historical currents swirling around the Boston Tea Party. The Boston Tea Party had revolutionary significance. It set the stage for an American rebellion and the war that followed. The Tea Party was an expression of political ideology about taxes, rights, and authority. Just as important, it was a window onto American culture and society of the time. Americans' consumer habits, including the colonists' love of tea, played a role in the way the resistance unfolded. Prevailing views of American Indians in colonial society help us to understand the disguises that the destroyers wore. Boston's colonial legacy of riotous parades, angry protest, and political organization provided the ingredients that made the Tea Party possible. These elements offer a fuller picture of why the Tea Party happened. The destruction of the tea was a quintessential rejection of authority that became a cherished American tradition. The Tea Party involved a relatively broad segment of the population, even though this was an era when only the elite were thought fit to rule and make decisions. Because of this, the destruction set a world standard for future democratic protest. From the British perspective, the Boston Tea Party was the culmination of a decade's worth of flawed imperial policy, and the event certainly played a part in its imperial legacy. To Americans, the Tea Party became an emblem of their faith that a determined and organized group can accomplish momentous political change, culminating in independence. The participants were men who showed their willingness to defy the law in defense of their rights. To this day, journalists, pundits, and politicians frequently cite the Tea Party as the first and most famous example of Americans' heritage of civil disobedience, their penchant for secret conspiracies, and their aversion to foreign trade restrictions, excessive taxation, or government overreach. By reading the tea leaves at the bottom of Boston Harbor, we can see the American character itself taking shape. The day after the Tea Party, the attorney and future president, John Adams, called it the most magnificent movement of all. He went on, "There is a dignity, a majesty, a sublimity in this last effort of the Patriots that I greatly admire." Not everyone agreed. Some found the story of the Tea Party to be inspiring and democratic, but others called it riotous, disorderly, and disturbing. They saw a pack of rebels who had disobeyed the law, destroyed private property, and threatened anyone who stood in their way. 18th-century Boston was a town where crowd action was not uncommon. From time to time, townspeople pulled down opponents' houses, brawled with soldiers, threw bricks at officials, tarred and feathered civilians, and otherwise asserted their power. In this climate, the tea consignees and senior customs officials had feared for their lives to such a degree that they fled to Castle Island offshore. By December 16, 1773, Bostonians had topped it all off with the invasion and destruction of private property as part of their political protest. The kind of political movement that birthed the Tea Party protest and the revolution seems both exciting and extreme. Throughout history and today, the Boston Tea Party has given off mixed signals, in part because it involved so little bloodshed, no one died at the Boston Tea Party. It became a formative expression of liberty, independence, and civil disobedience, representing the finest human tradition of nonviolent resistance to tyranny. The Tea Party was sublime, in John Adams's words, because it was a rejection of arbitrary rule. The Tea Party is also stirring in its radical potential for mobilizing people from all walks of life. Most people can't imagine themselves in knee breeches signing the Declaration of Independence, but they can easily imagine destroying the East India Company's tea. At the same time, the Boston Tea Party is also downright frightening, in that it seems to justify the bullying nullification of any law that an outspoken group dislikes, whether it is slavery, damage to the environment, racial discrimination, legal abortion, court-ordered busing, taxation of any sort, or illegal immigration. The Tea Party opens up Pandora's box. Out comes chaos, but also hope. In this way, it exemplifies an ongoing struggle in America between law and order and democratic protest. Perhaps we should not be too quick to embrace the Boston Tea Party, which many authorities would today classify as an act of terrorism, as a gauzy, harmless tale of American origins. Americans enshrine their traditions of democratic protest, but they also profess to respect law and order, and our regard for the Boston Tea Party stands at the frontier of these two values. The Boston Tea Party remains an important historical event, not just because it brought about dramatic change in its time, but because it still resonates today. Chapter 1. The Empire's Corporation. Great Britain should not only assert but also support that supremacy which she claims over the members of the Empire, or she will soon only be supreme in words. Thomas Gage, April 13, 1772. In May 1750, the Boston Town Meeting expressed concern that a provincial tax on tea and coffee would bring on the displeasure of those two great and powerful corporations, the East India and Turkey Companies, in our mother country. 23 years later, as ships bearing tea made their way to Boston, the same town meeting fumed that the East India Company had launched a violent attack upon the liberties of America. Although Bostonians had previously admired the East India Company from a distance and enjoyed its tea, in 1773 they cast the company as a monster, as a danger to the colonists' freedoms. The people of Boston were caught up in the storm and stress of Great Britain's struggle to manage its expanding empire. At the dawn of the 17th century, the Crown of England had created the East India Company, the earliest American colonies, and other global ventures in much the same way. England was then too weak to send its military forces to the far corners of the world, so the Crown had sent chartered companies to do the work of conquest, trade, and settlement. Queen Elizabeth I granted the East India Company, EIC, its charter in 1600 as one of these private ventures, just as King Charles I gave the Massachusetts Bay Company its charter in 1629. In effect, the English government had subcontracted the business of imperialism to adventurers willing to undertake the risk and reap the potential rewards of an overseas voyage. Since its founding, the EIC had been trading, fortifying, making allies, and fighting rivals, literally with guns, in the East Indies and beyond. Queen Elizabeth's charter granted the company a licensed monopoly on all English trade east of the Cape of Good Hope. The EIC carried spices, silk, cotton, opium, gold, silver, and tea across enormous distances, paying out generous dividends to its shareholders. In the 17th and 18th centuries, most people assumed that such monopoly grants were beneficial. They would help the company, as an extension of the English national interest, stand up to the country's continental European rivals. The trade bolstered the economy and helped to support the government through payment of customs duties. The company became, along with the Bank of England, part of the backbone of national finance. Of course, there was a downside in monopoly companies. They stifled competition, and a corporation with such enormous power also wielded inordinate leverage over indigenous Indian Ocean traders. Nevertheless, the shareholders enjoyed the company's relative freedom, and the company did its best to take advantage of its trade networks, its financial power, and its government connections. During the 18th century, Robert Clive became the most famous of the company's adventurers in South Asia. Clive was tough, daring, and manic-depressive, and he had amassed a great fortune during his years of energetic service for the company. He earned his fame in Great Britain and wheedled an Irish barony for himself in part because he had defeated the Nawab of Bengal at the Battle of Plassey in 1757. In 1765, Lord Clive was serving as the company's governor and commander-in-chief at Bengal. He arranged for the company to assume the Diwani, or civil administration, over Bengal's 20 million people, convinced that its revenues could yield an annual profit of £1.6 million and more. Over the next few years, the EIC aggressively assumed the authority of an imperial government in Bengal, collecting taxes, building up its military presence, striking new and often obnoxious arrangements with local merchants and artisans, encouraging the development of cash crops, stripping local elites of their power, and increasing its control over the territory. Starry-eyed British optimists were enthusiastic about these developments. The company's new acquisitions, the Gentleman's Magazine speculated, may open to this nation such a mine of wealth as in a few years to enable administration to pay off the national debt, to take off the land tax, and ease the poor of burdensome taxes. The company already paid customs duties that amounted to around a third of the customs revenue for the entire nation. In 1767, the ministry decided to sink its teeth into the Bengal revenues as well. The EIC, hoping to keep these profits for its shareholders, did its best to beat back the ministry's efforts. As a compromise, the company granted what was in effect an annual bribe to Parliament of £400,000, 4% of the Treasury's total revenue, in exchange for keeping government oversight off its back. As the writer for the Gentleman's Magazine had hoped, these new Indian revenues helped Great Britain reduce the land tax on its own subjects at home. The interests of company shareholders and the British state were now closely tied. The British public also began to comprehend the darker side of British involvement in India. The company accumulated a long record of irresponsible greed and corruption in the 1760s. East India Company employees like Robert Clive, Thomas Rumbold, John Caillou, George Pigott, and others returned from their service in India as nabobs and flaunted their newfound riches. They acquired seats in Parliament, baronetcies, Irish peerages, and knighthoods. A newspaper correspondent warned that Parliament needed to consider new regulations in conducting the affairs of the East India Company and of limiting the power of their servants abroad, who have all showed an eagerness to return home early in life with nabobs' fortunes, which can only be acquired by embroiling the company in perpetual war. In Bengal, meanwhile, money was growing scarcer, and the population had become more vulnerable to natural cycles of drought and flood. Lest anyone try to fault the company for these difficulties, EIC employees blamed the indigenous rulers of Bengal as untrustworthy, vice-ridden, and despotic. Back in its plush offices on Leadenhall Street in London, the East India Company could do little about their employees' independent trading and often rampant corruption, just two ingredients in a riot of mismanagement that almost tore apart the company in the years 1769 to 73. Suddenly, the gods turned angry in Bengal in the fall of 1769. Not a drop of rain fell. The paddy withered in the fields and became like straw. This was how the 19th century novelist Bankimchandra Chatterjee described the suffering in Northeast India in Anandamat, the book of historical fiction that he published in 1882. For most of the 18th century, Bengal was a rich corner of the once powerful Mughal Empire. Farmers coaxed crops from fertile fields, muslin weavers and silk winders unfurled magnificent fabrics that were prized throughout the world. Traders shuttled goods up and down the Ganges River Valley. Now, as the ground hardened, the drought choked the life out of half the land's crop. Scarcity soon drove the price of rice to more than 20, in some places 50, times its normal rate. Once again, people went hungry. First, they skipped a meal, then even the one meal they had was reduced by half, and finally, they fasted throughout the day. People started to beg. Soon there was no one to give alms, so they started to go hungry. Then they began to succumb to disease. Then they sold their cattle, their plows and cattle yokes, finished off their seed paddy, and sold all their possessions. Then they sold their land. After this, they started selling their girl children, then the boys, and then their wives. Finally, who was there to buy the children and the wives? There were no buyers, since everyone wanted to sell. For lack of food, they began to eat the leaves of trees and grass and weeds. The low caste and those who lived in the forests started to eat dogs, mice, and cats. As corpses piled up in the streets and bazaars of Murshidabad and Calcutta, the scholar Karam Ali wrote, "People could not find the time or inclination even to bury their dead. Jackals, vultures, pigs, and dogs made prey of human carcasses. There were even whispered accounts of far worse." In early reports of this disaster, observers guessed that Bengal lost a third of its population, later estimated to be about 10 million people. Although the death toll was probably closer to 1.2 million, the famine's reaping of human life was undeniable. Had it struck the 13 colonies of North America, it would have wiped out half of the entire population. Some regions of Bengal indeed lost about half their people to starvation. Tigers and elephants roamed through deserted settlements as the jungle reclaimed the landscape. Bengal was starting to look like a country sucked dry, not just by the fateful shifts of nature, but by the profit-seeking of traders and tax collectors. "This affliction comes from the hand of your countrymen," said the sufferers who confronted one English witness. The company provided only a few scraps of charitable relief, and it did little to ease its taxation of the region during the famine, as the earlier Muslim Mughal regime had done in times of scarcity. Instead, the company stockpiled grain to feed its own garrisons and kept dunning its new subjects for revenue even as the carnage mounted. As Chatterjee wrote, "People could die of starvation, but the collection of revenue didn't stop." Warren Hastings, the new governor of Bengal in 1772, reported to London in chilling terms that revenue collection had been violently kept up to its former standard. The pocketing of bribes by company employees continued as well, while Parliament and the British press were a six-month journey away. But news of the calamity and the corruption eventually broke. Horace Walpole, a member of Parliament and the son of a former prime minister, wrote, "The oppressions of India, and even of the English settled there, under the rapine and cruelties of the servants of the company, had now reached England and created general clamor here." The public blamed the Bengal famine on the monopolistic practices of East India Company agents. A tithe, tenth, of these crimes was sufficient to inspire horror. In the coffee houses of London, people began to look upon the riches accumulated by company servants like Lord Clive, the former Bengal governor, and his fellow Erivist nabobs with disgust. William Bolts, himself a former company merchant in Calcutta, pointed to the company servants who, after exhibiting such scenes of barbarity as can scarcely be paralleled in the history of any country, have returned to England loaded with wealth. William Pitt the Elder, now Lord Chatham, despised these nabobs who had no natural interest in the soil and called them mere importers of foreign gold engaged in private corruption. Alexander Dow, a former EIC army officer, spoke of the gloom of Bengal and warned, "The ruin which we have brought on an unfortunate country will recoil upon ourselves." A few whispers about the melancholy news of the Bengal famine eventually found their way to the western reaches of the British Empire, to Boston and New York and Philadelphia. American colonists initially said little about the news, although reports reached them just as they were contemplating their own place in the empire. Still, they must have been shocked by what they read in reprints from London newspapers. One account described an Englishman who had returned from Bengal having amassed above £100,000 by a monopoly of rice, and to which monopoly, it is said, was chiefly owing the late terrible and affecting famine in that country, by which nearly 100,000 unhappy people lost their lives. Who would wish the enjoyment of riches at such a price? Another item read, "The cruelties exercised upon the innocent natives of Bengal for some years past, and the scene of rapine that has been carried on there by the servants of the company, call aloud to heaven itself for vengeance." By 1773, Americans' mute bemusement would turn to fear that they might be next. Meanwhile, the fate of the company in Great Britain was worsening. Once the British public had woken to the possibilities for profit in Bengal in the 1760s, increasing investments had turned to frenzied speculation in company stock. Then, when investors heard news in 1769 about a military setback in Madras, now Chennai, the bubble burst. Waves of financial panic and distress reverberated worldwide. A few years later, in the summer of 1772, Alexander Fordyce, a suave, handsome Scottish investor, who was later satirized as a macaroni gambler, bet more money than his bank had on East India Company stock. He guessed wrong, and his mistake threw an entire network of heavily leveraged banks into ruin. In Amsterdam, the newspapers called it a British twister and blamed the EIC. Fordyce himself fled to France, but the damage was done. As if connected by an electrical wire, the Scottish writer James Boswell observed, the people in every corner of the country have almost instantaneously received the same shock. The twister of bankruptcies blew throughout England and Scotland. Indeed, as it became harder to secure new loans, the shock of the banking crisis was eventually felt in the West Indies and North America, and across Europe as far as Russia. The inability to borrow money only added to disgruntlement in the North American colonies. The East India Company's stock was sinking, and it threatened to take the British imperial economy down with it. Thomas Pownall, a member of Parliament and former Massachusetts governor, wrote that the Bengal revenues had been wrought into the very frame and composition of our finances. There seemed to be no way of going back. To make matters worse, the East India Company was bleeding its dividends out to shareholders, many of whom were members of Parliament, at rates that had ballooned from 6% in the early 1760s to 12.5%, rather than reinvesting its profits into the company's infrastructure, or reducing its prices, or easing up on revenue collection in Bengal. The Chinese tea trade presented the company's directors with another headache. The EIC depended on monopolizing the trade of this valuable commodity, and the British Treasury stood to gain a great deal from customs revenue. Without competition, or at least without legal competition, the company could charge high prices, which more than covered its shipping expenses and tax obligations. And so the EIC had been steadily ordering more and more tea from China. It was a colossal mistake. British and foreign smugglers were bringing in thousands of pounds of illegally imported tea and offering it to British customers at cut rates. Perhaps the majority of the tea consumed in the British Isles was smuggled from the European mainland, where the Dutch, French, Swedes, and other nations had their own Chinese import companies. With all of this tea business going to illegal competitors, tea began piling up in company warehouses unsold. The amount now stood at over 17.5 million pounds of the leaf, more than everyone in England drank in a year, potentially worth over 2 million pounds but sinking in value. Sir George Colebrooke, a banker educated at the University of Leiden, was chairman of the East India Company in 1772, and his company now faced a desperate situation. The EIC was losing more money than it had on hand. Its expenses on military fortifications in India were eating up more and more of the budget. The company had still not worked out the kinks of its revenue collecting in Bengal. Meanwhile, its own agents, nabobs like Clive, were making private fortunes that cut into the company's profits. Its stock was tanking. The banking crisis led to delays in some payments that were due to the company, and those pungent piles of tea filled thousands of crates worth of unrealized profit. Every year, the East India Company turned to the Bank of England for a loan to cover temporary shortfalls until the company could collect its earnings from sales. By summer, the company's debts were mounting, and it was begging the bank for further loans. This time, the bank refused. The EIC also owed the British government over £1 million, £400,000 for the annual payment, and the rest for customs duties. By autumn, the company's total debts were staggering, over £1.3 million. Its only solution was to suspend payment of the annual dividend to shareholders for that year. Now Parliament and the shareholders were paying attention. John Burgoyne, a member of Parliament, who would later lead an army against American troops at Saratoga, headed a parliamentary select committee to address the problem. In May 1773, His committee began inquiring into the offenses that Lord Clive and other company employees had committed in South Asia. The British cabinet under Prime Minister Lord North seized on the climate of negative publicity surrounding the company and vowed to take greater control over its corrupt practices and financial troubles. The EIC would remain an independent company, but now it would answer to the British state. First, Parliament passed the Restraining Act, which temporarily prevented the company from sending out any new supervisors to India. A few months later, the Regulating Act gave greater power to the company's larger shareholders with the idea that this would ensure stability. The Regulating Act also prohibited private trade by company servants, provided for regular government supervision of company affairs, and put executive and judicial power in India more firmly in Parliament's grip. The British government was attempting to resume and redefine the authority that it had formerly delegated to its chartered Eastern venture. Imperial expansion and consolidation, the credit crisis, and changes in the tea trade were bedeviling Parliament and the EIC, but they affected the American colonies, too. The 7 Years' War, known to Americans as the French and Indian War, had ended in 1763, realigning the balance of power in North America, India, and Europe. The Treaty of Paris, signed that year, had granted French territories in North America and Eastern India to Great Britain, removing the French threat from these regions. Great Britain's star seemed to be ascending. At the same time, the war had also saddled the British government with crippling debts and massive naval and military commitments in the Indian Ocean and the Trans-Appalachian West. The British government wanted a return on its investment in these overseas wars, naval squadrons, and troop commitments. From the American colonies, Parliament asked for new taxes and tighter customs enforcement. From the East India Company, Parliament asked for the yearly $400,000 tribute in 1767, and it passed the Regulating Act of 1773. The British government also hardened its enforcement of customs laws in America, giving new powers to judges, naval officers, and customs officials to make sure customs duties flowed back to the British Treasury on schedule. The colonists and company directors, though they had little interaction with one another, now had something in common. They had seen Parliament's vision of an overseas empire for Great Britain, and they felt the reins tightening on India and America. In response, the chartered companies and colonies began fighting as hard as they could to hold on to their rights. American colonial legislatures tried to be savvy about lobbying the government in England. The mainland colonies, including Massachusetts, had long retained agents to look after their interests. The attorney William Bolin, son-in-law of former Governor William Shirley, had operated on behalf of Massachusetts since the 1740s and was serving as agent for the colony's council in the 1770s. When the aged Flemish merchant, Denys de Barrett, passed away in 1770, the Massachusetts House of Representatives appointed the Boston-born scientist Benjamin Franklin as its agent. In addition, the colonies had a few scattered allies in and around Parliament, such as the scar-faced war veteran Colonel Isaac Barry, the fluent orator Edmund Burke, and the controversial John Wilkes, a former MP who became an alderman and sheriff and later mayor of London. These pro-American allies were useful, but the coalition was loose because Americans had such a diverse array of economic interests. Compared to the lobbyists, agents, and members of Parliament working for West Indian sugar planters and East India Company shareholders, the Americans' influence seemed distant and uncertain. Furthermore, as a Boston merchant in London pointed out, the British aristocracy held American interests in contempt. "Manufacturers and commercial people, so far as their interest is affected, are on our side," he wrote, "but all the landed interests are against us." He continued, "The House of Peers are not friendly. One of that House said some time ago that in a few years he expected all his old family pictures and furniture would adorn a hall in America." The old money British aristocracy expressed distaste for new money nabobs from America as well as the East and West Indies. In the mid-1760s, many Americans started to resist the taxes that Parliament tried to levy. Throughout the colonies, respectable protesters and unruly crowds gathered to assert American rights. They objected to the idea of extracting revenue from the colonies without the colonists' consent. In the process, the American dissidents began to forge their objections into a distinct set of ideas about government. Politicians like Samuel Adams of Boston or Patrick Henry of Virginia believed that the local legislatures, dating back to the early 17th century, were the colonists' rightful representatives, not the distant members of Parliament, whom they had no power to choose. The colonists also wanted their assemblies, and not Parliament, to have power to choose and fund the colony's executive branch. In 1767, Parliament passed two laws affecting the East India Company's tea shipments. The first, designed to help the company, was the Indemnity Act, which lowered the duty on all black tea and cheap green tea, Singlo tea, sold in England. The act also granted a drawback, or refund, on all import duties on tea being reshipped to America. In other words, if the company imported a chest of tea from China and paid taxes on it, then reshipped that tea to America, it could have its taxes on that tea chest refunded. Parliament hoped that the act, by allowing the company to sell tea to consumers at a lower price, would discourage smugglers. At the same time, Parliament hated the thought of losing government revenue from tea sales, so they insisted that the East India Company make up the difference. The company had hoped for commercial gains from the provisions of the Indemnity Act, but the second act, which became known as the Townshend Act, threatened to wipe out these gains. Young Charles Townshend, Chancellor of the Exchequer, proposed taxes on all tea, glass, paper, lead, and paint imported into the American colonies. This measure would raise funds to offset the tax breaks of the Indemnity Act and would pay the salaries of civil officials in America. Most of the taxed items were relatively insignificant to transatlantic trade, except for tea, which now bore a duty of 3 pence per pound. Because the taxes on tea in the British Isles were particularly high, Americans still paid less for tea than British customers did. Regardless, Americans objected to the new tax on principle. The specter of taxation without representation haunted the American colonists. The lawyer John Dickinson, posing as a farmer in Pennsylvania, wrote that Parliament was now dictating taxes to the King's American subjects, not to regulate trade or encourage commerce, but for the single purpose of levying money upon us. This was the most dangerous innovation. Dickinson's protest was echoed by thundering sermons and newspaper articles throughout the colonies, as well as citywide boycotts of British imports and even outright violence. The East India Company and a group of London merchants, eager for American customers and fearful of American boycotts, joined the chorus of protesters asking for the Townshend duties to be repealed to little avail. Parliament stuck a finger in the dam with a political solution. To pacify the colonists, in 1770, they repealed most of the Townshend duties. To make sure Americans knew that Parliament retained the right to tax the colonies, and to ensure that the colonies would remain a source of revenue, they kept the tax on tea in place. In the colony of Massachusetts, many people saw these issues of taxes and legislation through the prism of protecting their rights under the Massachusetts Charter. Under the colony's original Royal Charter of 1629, the male colonists had the power to direct their own affairs in town meetings, and they elected their own members of the Massachusetts House of Representatives. They saw the Massachusetts Bay Colony Charter as a sacred covenant between themselves and the king, akin to the covenants that God had made with Noah and Abraham in the Old Testament. After upheaval in England and New England during the Glorious Revolution, Massachusetts received a new charter from Parliament in 1691. The crown would appoint the colony's governors, and those governors served at the king's pleasure. Members of the council, the legislature's upper house, were chosen by a joint conference of the house and the outgoing council, but Massachusetts governors had the power to veto the appointment of councillors or any law passed by both houses. This new blueprint for Massachusetts government did nothing to settle its politics. The Massachusetts House of Representatives, claiming the mantle of representing the people, insisted on keeping a tight leash on the governor's salary and expenditures, as well as his powers over the legislature. When the British ministry decided to start paying the Massachusetts governor, as well as the province's chief judges and attorneys, Directly out of the duties collected on tea, dissidents like Samuel Adams worried that this new policy would render these officials independent of the Massachusetts legislature. The ministry's decision to take these salaries wholly out of the hands of the legislature looked like another infringement on the people's liberty. Parliament had begun trying to strengthen its control over governors and councils in the American colonies, as well as the East India Company. One way to do this was by making sure it had the power to appoint and supervise officials, and another was by making sure that the British government had firmer control over the officials' salaries. For Massachusetts, Parliament took the salaries of civil officials away from the local legislature and began paying them directly from the British Treasury. For the East India Company, Parliament granted greater salaries to key company employees so as to discourage corruption, since a well-compensated official, in theory, would be less likely to seek bribes, gifts, favors, and other private profits in India. Yet a certain circle of opposition politicians in England worried that these fat salaries would just shift the corruption to England. The politicians in the British ministry could reward their friends with plum positions, and they could lavish these British, colonial, and company employees with grossly high salaries. This arrangement, known as patronage, led to dangerous corruption at home. In America, critics often use the derogatory term placemen to describe exploitative crown officials in their midst. Nabobs who went to distant lands and made money for themselves may have offended the British upper classes, but to opposition politicians and dissident colonists, an imperial government sending its salaried officials to distant lands to make money for the state and themselves was an even more fearsome prospect. As the writer Atticus wrote to Lord North, "With the company's wealth and influence at your feet, with those extensive powers of corruption in your hands, America too must now submit to the wretched system of the favorite." Tea was becoming the means by which the British Empire would degenerate into corruption and tyranny. Americans resented paying taxes on East India Company tea, but they blamed Parliament for this, not the company itself. Some of them hoped that they could join forces with the company as fellow defenders of chartered rights. The Duke of Richmond, an opposition leader in Parliament, urged the East India Company's stockholders in May 1773 not to lie at the mercy of administration, but to resist, like Englishmen, every illegal attack upon their chartered rights and privileges. American protests against recent acts of Parliament echoed this warning, as in the town of Beverly, Massachusetts, which described the use of tax revenue to pay the salaries of civil officers, an infringement on our charter rights, which has a direct tendency to the destruction of our happy Constitution. The Regulating Act of 1773 also manipulated salaries to control Indian officials, and it was similarly resented. In September 1773, the Boston Committee of Correspondence forwarded a letter to all the other towns of Massachusetts detailing how, under the Regulating Act, the East India Company's sacred charter rights were arbitrarily taken from them, which alarmed other chartered institutions, including the City of London itself. These American radicals initially tried to cast the company as a sibling in the struggle for liberty, a fellow victim of the British ministry's attempts to foist placemen upon them. In the event, the idea that the colonies and the company were siblings was superficial at best. As Americans learned more about the provisions of the new East India Company laws, they realized that Parliament would sooner lend a hand to the company than the colonies, and that the ministry had decided to play the interests of the company and the American colonies off one another. Parliament had unmistakably tightened the reins on the EIC, but it had also preserved the company as its partner in the pursuit of profits and the government of its holdings in India. In 1773, Parliament bailed out the company to the tune of a £1.4 million loan. Then the accompanying Tea Act paved the way for the EIC to pay off its debts by making it easier for the company to unload its surplus tea at America's expense. Where would the EIC find a market for its tea? Europe and England were out of the question. These markets were already glutted, and the company could hardly compete with the European East India companies and their partners, British smugglers, given its high prices and hands-off practice of using middlemen to sell tea to retailers. America, on the other hand, was the emerging market for consumer goods of all kinds. Once again, the company's proprietors asked permission to ship tea directly to the American colonies duty-free, but the ministry's priorities were clear. Lord North, the Prime Minister, was in no mood to repeal the last Townsend duty. If he did, it would look as if Parliament had conceded an important point about its right to tax the Americans. Colebrook, the company's chairman, suggested that North could save face by claiming that he repealed the tea tax at the company's request. North refused, although he admitted he had rather do it at the desire of the India Company than that of America. Lord North's stubbornness led to a compromise that propped up the East India Company, but still extracted revenue from the colonists. Under the Tea Act, Parliament would give a tax rebate to the company on tea shipped to America. This measure would allow the company to offer a lower price to American customers. The Tea Act would make tea cheaper, not more expensive, while Parliament could continue to collect the 3-penny duty on every pound of imported tea. Aside from the tax, Parliament's plan for shipping the tea also offended the colonists. In the past, English and American merchants had been able to compete for the right to buy cargoes of tea in London and ship them to America for a healthy profit. Now the East India Company would be able to handpick its own consignees or agents and sell tea directly to the American colonies. To Lord North, this appeared to be the perfect solution. The new arrangement would reduce the surplus of tea in the company's warehouses, Americans would buy more tea at lower prices, the company's profit margins would increase, and the British Treasury would take its own sanctioned cut. In response, just a month after the Boston Committee's circular letter, the Massachusetts House of Representatives issued another missive with a new, more fearful interpretation of the Tea Act. It is easy to see how aptly this scheme, while helping the East India Company, will serve both to destroy the trade of the colonies and increase the revenue. A committee representing Boston and its neighboring towns announced, "We know that great dependence is placed upon this masterpiece of policy for accomplishing the purpose of enslaving us." The Tea Act conjured up nightmare visions of enslavement and ruin. First, it reaffirmed Parliament's right to tax the colonists without their consent, a point that more and more Americans were refusing to concede. If Parliament could continue to raise taxes on Americans without any consequences, eventually Americans would be little better than feudal vassals. Second, Parliament had already determined that those taxes would fund the salary of the Royal Governor of Massachusetts and other provincial officers. The tea tax, pulled from the colonists' own pockets, robbed the New England colonists of this leverage over executive and judicial officials. This seemed the first step to tyranny, an imperial government sending hired tyrants to rob the colonies blind. Third, the Tea Act appeared to grant special privileges to a monopolistic company, the East India Company, at the expense of American merchants. The Massachusetts colonists might have felt some sympathy and solidarity with the company in the name of chartered rights, but not if the company was going to make money at Americans' expense. Using its unfair competitive advantage, the East India Company could now starve the American people of their livelihood, while imperial courtiers and their cronies were scheming to take the rest of it. Americans worried that, poorly connected as they were in London, they would suffer a fate worse than Bengal's. In a series of 5 pamphlets, a New York son of liberty named Hampton painted a picture of the East India Company as an evil monopoly built on bribes. "Wonder not, then," wrote the author, "that power thus obtained at the expense of the national commerce should be used to the most tyrannical and cruel purposes." Referring to the famine in Bengal, the author called the East India Company lost to all the feelings of humanity as they monopolized the absolute necessaries of life in India at a time of apprehended scarcity. Now the purchase of the company's iniquities, tea, must be sent to the colonies, the profit of which is to support the tyranny of the last in the East, enslave the West, and prepare us fit victims for the exercise of that horrid inhumanity they have practiced in the face of the sun on the helpless Asiatics. A Newport paper chimed in, disgusted that the company had probably shed more innocent blood over the previous 20 years, slaying perhaps as many as 3 million people, than all the world's other wars combined. John Dickinson, the lawyer who had become famous for his letters from a farmer in Pennsylvania against the Townsend duties, took up the pen name Rusticus and launched a similar attack on the East India Company. Their conduct in Asia for some years past has given ample proof how little they regard the laws of nations, the rights, liberties, or lives of men. Dickinson continued, "They have, by the most unparalleled barbarities, extortions, and monopolies, stripped the miserable inhabitants of their property and reduced whole provinces to indigence and ruin. 1,500,000, it is said, perished by famine in 1 year, not because the earth denied its fruits, but this company and their servants engrossed all the necessaries of life and set them at so high a rate that the poor could not purchase them. Having drained Bengal of its wealth and corrupted it, they now, it seems, cast their eyes on America as a new theater whereon to exercise their talents of rapine, oppression, and cruelty. The monopoly of tea is, I dare say, but a small part of the plan they have formed to strip us of our property. But thank God, we are not sepoys nor Marathas, but British subjects who are born to liberty, who know its worth, and who prize it high. In highly politicized American cities like Philadelphia and Boston, most people apparently agreed with Dickinson that the Tea Act would have dire consequences if it were allowed to stand. As the EIC began shipping tea to America under this unacceptable new law, the question became, what would Americans do about the tea? During the 1760s and 1770s, Great Britain began to come to terms with its massive empire. It was in 1773, in fact, that Sir George Macartney referred to this vast empire on which the sun never sets and whose bounds nature has not yet ascertained. Bengali weavers, Iroquois hunters, Irish peasants, Afro-Caribbean slaves, Boston shipwrights, Virginian planters, and Quebecois habitants all fell within the British sphere of dominion. Representatives of the imperial government, governors, military officers, and other officials depended on local cooperation, and they usually had the wisdom to be flexible with the king's overseas subjects. Ultimately, however, the British ministry became impatient with these flexible arrangements. Parliament tried to tighten its grip over trade, revenue, and governance, especially in South Asia and the mutinous colonies of North America. From this point of view, chartered organizations like the East India Company and the New England colonies, formed as military ventures in the 17th century, were no longer useful. The company and the American colonies would either submit to the laws of the 18th century commercial empire or be brought to heel. The Bengal famine was a deadly symptom of the East India Company's struggle to administer India and the British government's struggle to administer the empire as a whole. These struggles caused a shudder that was felt not just in Boston during the tea conflict, but all around the world. Lord Clive, hero of the Battle of Plassey, felt the shudder. He spent the year 1773 defending himself in Parliament against the Burgoyne Committee's charges of corruption. He was reduced to begging, "Leave me my honor, take away my fortune." Although Parliament exonerated him, and he kept both, Clive was driven into one of his habitual bouts of depression and illness, and he never recovered. Clive either committed suicide or overdosed on opium and died of a seizure in his grand London home on November 22, 1774. In another example of the connections between America and India, the trappings of Clive's wealth and fame included a painting by the American Benjamin West, a favorite of George III. It was supposed to be a series commemorating events in the life of an adventurer in Asia, but only the first was ever finished. China felt the shudder, even though its imperial government had done its best to keep European traders on a short leash. China made handsome profits selling tea to Europe, but Western nations became impatient with all the silver they were dumping into Chinese coffers. The British East India Company, searching for a way to make famine-scorched Bengal profitable, needed another product to trade to China. Opium turned out to be the solution to both problems. Once the EIC decided to ignore the Chinese ban on opium and seek out the profits of the drug trade, its directors declared a monopoly on the Indian opium trade in 1773. Over the next few years, The company stepped up its shipments of this Indian-grown plant, both painkiller and poison, by smuggling it into Chinese harbors. By 1810, Emperor Daoguang vowed to snuff out the wicked traders who pursue high profits on sales and purchase of opium. The following year, observing how addicts would buy opium instead of food and clothing, he wrote, "Opium will destroy our people's morality." In Edinburgh, the economist Adam Smith felt the shudder. Bengal's apparent decline struck him as proof that the East India Company's monopoly and the strange absurdity of a joint stock company ruling as sovereign was a disaster. The starving Indians were certainly suffering, and Britain suffered too, from monopolistic price gouging, from the rot of corruption, waste, fraud, and abuse which were inseparable from the management of the affairs of so great a company. Smith's writings on free trade in 1776 would have lasting influence on economic thought in both hemispheres. Urdu poets in Delhi and Patna felt the shudder as well. With haunted eyes, they saw the changes wrought by grasping British company men and invoked the word Inkilab, or revolution. The social order was being disrupted. Rapacious traders and officials were pursuing profits without honor. The heavens' wrath was raining down upon India. The world was turning upside down. In the years following the passage of the Tea Act, Americans would come to know this feeling too. Chapter 2. The Ringleader of All Violence. A storm in this town is raised in the twinkling of an eye, without your having the least warning. Such an absolute sway have our leaders over the minds of the common people that in an instant they will raise you a tempest that would threaten destruction to the globe. Nathaniel Coffin, May 22, 1770. In 1770, Thomas Hutchinson was in many ways the first man of Boston. He had come from a wealthy family and had ranked third in social prominence among his classmates at Harvard College. He was proud, honorable to a fault, and extremely protective of his personal reputation. He had risen through the ranks of local and provincial office to serve as magistrate, representative, speaker of the House, counselor, chief justice of the highest court, lieutenant governor, and governor. His attention to detail had made him successful.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.